was asked to explain a little bit before the talk about our current project in Norway, but I'll talk about that later. But as you see, these monasteries have spread very far. The tradition of Lumpocha, Ajahn Chah, has been growing steadily and going to many different countries. So the last one of these places is in Norway, where there are a lot of Thai people living in Norway, but there is no real, like a Wat Pah, like a forest monastery yet. So we got a very big piece of land, about 200 rai of forest, a very beautiful place. And we are just starting to project to build some kuti for the monks to stay in the forest. So we can benefit from the very peaceful natural environment for meditation. And as you may know, Norway is a very cold country at the moment. I think last week it was like minus 20 degrees, and somebody sent some pictures. It looks very, very nice in the ice and cold. Monks have to learn how to use the skis, maybe. Chongkrom with the ski. Ski bindabat. But anyway, it's possible to live anywhere. That's the main topic of the talk today. I want to talk about how Lumpocha was able to adapt to the conditions outside of Thailand. But in Norway, this is basically, we are trying to live the same way of life as forest monks. That means having good opportunities for meditation, and also if we build like a sala later, there's a lot of space to do meditation. Anybody can come and join. And there is also the project to make a Buddha statue, Prapratan, from sandstone here in Thailand, and have it in the sala, something like that. So that's the current project. There's some information about that. So today I thought to start by talking a little bit about this significant year. This year is remembering 100 years of Ajahn Chah, Lumpocha anniversary, counting from his birth 100 years ago. So I've just been to Wat Nom Bapong and Wat Pah Nanachat in Ubon province last month on the 16th of January. As every year, there is the annual big gathering of all the disciples, all the students of Ajahn Chah. So some of the old monks, they are quite old now, like Lobo Sumedho is already more than 80, and you can see the first generation is slowly kind of fading away. The life is coming to an end, and then there is the sort of the middle generation who maybe still met Ajahn Chah or saw him but didn't live with him for very long. And then there's like the younger ones, like myself, who never met him and never lived with him. So that's something to kind of reflect on. You know, how do we receive the teachings from like a famous teacher, a great teacher, a great master? What does it mean to be like a student or a disciple, follower of a teacher? If you remember the Buddha himself, when the Buddha was going to pass away, then some people, some of the monks, were very disappointed, very kind of upset, and some people were crying. And then Venerable Sariputta, he asked, you know, when the Buddha passes away, or when he passed away, did he take away or his sila, or his moral conduct, his samadhi, his concentration, his panya, his wisdom, and his vimutti or liberation, did those things disappear? And those qualities, do they also disappear when the Buddha passed away into parinibbana? And the answer was no. The Buddha's teachings are timeless, akaliko. So even when the Buddha passes away, he doesn't take these teachings with him into parinibbana. They stay with us. That's the things he leaves behind. So that's the big difference, actually, between the Buddha's asana, the Buddhist teachings, and some of the other religions. If you study the other religions, say the theistic religions, they often rely on like a messiah, like a person who proclaims the teachings. And then it all depends on the actual person of that one person. And if you can't meet them, if you can't convert to this particular faith or make some connection with them, then you're kind of cut off from the possibility of salvation or liberation. You can't do anything, or maybe you can convert later, but it all depends on like a historical person. But in Buddhism it's not like that. It's whether it's the Buddha himself or later teachers and Krupa Ajahn, the principles of the Dhamma teachings are truly timeless, akaliko. Yeah? They are not limited to any particular time, so we haven't missed anything if we didn't meet a historical Buddha. We didn't miss anything if we didn't meet Ajahn Man or Ajahn Chah, because those teachings that they leave behind, the way of practice, we can still realize the fruits even today. If it wasn't like that, then it would go against that principle of the Buddhist teaching, like that we chant every day, sanditiko, akaliko, ehipasiko, opanayiko, these qualities of the Dhamma. Yeah, it's something that is visible here and now. You can make it actually real here and now. You don't have to wait till next life. Yeah, like in maybe other religions, they say, well, we don't know in this life, but we have to wait until we die, then we will see something in heaven. But in Buddhism, it's something that has to be realized here and now. Akaliko, not limited to any particular time. Ehipasiko, something that's like inviting us to come and see for ourselves, to prove that it's true. And everybody has to realize it individually, opanayiko, taking it inwards. So all these qualities of the Dhamma, if you go back, going back to Ajahn Chah, he was somebody in his whole way of teaching who stressed these kind of qualities. He didn't want people to become too dependent on him. There is always a tendency or a danger in if you have a very charismatic teacher, somebody who is really famous and draws a lot of attention, a lot of people come to see the teacher, it creates a kind of atmosphere around the teacher, and then everybody wants to spend time with him, and you get a kind of sense of uplift and refreshment and encouragement when you are with the teacher. But like some of the Western monks who stay with Ajahn Chah, they said that they could stay at his kuti until like very late at night, 1 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning, when Ajahn Chah used to teach. And he used to teach for like many hours, just talk to people, answer questions, and you could just sit there and listen to his talk and feel completely kind of absorbed in what he was saying and feel very energized and didn't want to go to sleep at all. But once they left his kuti and walked back to their kuti, then they would immediately like lose that sense of uplift and refreshment, because they were just depending on his kind of personality. And that's it's unreliable, it's impermanent. We can't just live off like the energy of another person too long. It's just being too dependent on a particular situation. So Ajahn Chah, he would actually frustrate people, those disciples, those students who would get too attached to him. He would send them away. He would send them to a really kind of uninspiring some kind of Ajahn who wasn't really teaching very much or wasn't behaving very well, and the place was really kind of horrible, uninspiring place. So then they could test the level of their practice. You know, if they thought that they couldn't practice in such a place, you know, because it wasn't uninspiring and the teacher wasn't doing what he was supposed to be doing, then it was a teaching opportunity. Ajahn Chah would use these kind of situations to show the monks that, you know, you have to teach yourself, really, in any possible situation. You have to, he said, your six senses, the ayatana, your eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind, these are your teachers. So you can have that anytime, anywhere. It doesn't have to be dependent on him being there all the time for you. So that's quite unique, you know, maybe because maybe other teachers will encourage that kind of sense of wanting the disciples to be dependent on them. And then what happens in such situations is if the teacher then dies and passes away, then there's nobody to replace him. And so the disciples, the followers, they kind of disappear, go their separate ways. But with Ajahn Chah, it seems that he created a situation and like a training environment where it could go on and continue until now, even though he's not there anymore. So that's quite unique, I think. The other, you know, interesting thing about him is I often reflect when I was reading his books. When I started reading his books, and then I read the Tipitaka, the Sutta, or the Pratraipitok, you read some of the original teachings of the Buddha, you can see that Ajahn Chah, he would sometimes refer indirectly to particular teachings that I find in the Pali text. Maybe some people don't realize it, but he was actually quite well-versed or studied. He studied some of the sort of traditional Pali teachings when he was a young monk. He was even teaching the Naktam study course. So he had quite a good knowledge of the text. He'd studied a bit of Pali, but not very much. So many times in his talks, he will refer actually to some of the traditional, more systematic teaching, but his way of using language is to make it kind of more easily understandable to normal people. So it's not too formal, it's not too kind of structured, you know, point by point. So when he gave his talks, you know, even ordinary people, and you know, just the villagers and farmers, they could just easily understand and follow what he was saying. And this is a particular quality that you find, the Buddha explained that there is a set of qualities called the Patisambhida Jnana, four kinds. And this is they are called analytical knowledges or analytical knowledge. And it refers to the ability to formulate and transmit some information, you know, the Dhamma teachings. And this is an ability that the Buddha obviously had to the highest degree. Because the Buddha, as we kind of believe, has developed over many, many lifetimes all these special qualities, the parami, different kinds of parami, the panya, especially wisdom, so that in his last life he could be the teacher the best qualified teacher to explain the Dhamma in all its facets. But his disciples, the other monks who were arahants, not everybody had the same kind of quality. So if you look in the Tipitaka, in the texts, the one who was most kind of qualified to teach after the Buddha was Venerable Sariputta. He could explain all the Dhamma teachings very well, just almost like the Buddha. And then there were others who could like explain, like Venerable Mahakachayana. He could explain like a short statement that the Buddha made, and he could explain it in a lot of detail, give a very detailed explanation. And also Venerable Ananda, the Buddha's attendant monk, he could remember and memorize all the teachings that the Buddha gave, and then he would sometimes quote it and explain things in his own way. So there were particular individuals with this kind of quality, which is very useful if you want to spread and transmit the some kind of information to a large number of people. Then the teachings have to be transmitted in such a way that it has to be systematic to some degree. So that's why the Buddha was teaching in quite a systematic way. But not everybody is able to absorb it in that way. So then you have to find other ways of doing it. There are like poems and similes, metaphors. So that's one thing about Ajahn Chah, I find, that you know, he had this ability to use language in a really quite special way. One of these Patisambhida analytical knowledges is to do with it's called Patibhana, the ability to make like comparisons and similes, metaphors, using the upama is. So all the teachings that you read of Ajahn Chah, he will often refer to something like animals and trees and just simple things of ordinary life, but they are very useful if you want to explain something. If you want to explain how the mind works, for example, there's a whole book of Ajahn Chah's metaphors and similes. Like he will say how Ajahn Chah explained meditation, you know, when we develop sati or mindfulness. He said you have to develop sati moment by moment, you know, steadily in a continuous way. And he said he compared it to like drops of water. If you have a tap open, the water is dripping. That's how it is in the beginning. We can only become aware, have sati, you know, one moment, and then we lose it, and then start again and lose it. But eventually the sati becomes continuous, becomes tonyang. It's just carries on all the time. So it's like when we open the tap and the water flows. So there's this sense of flowing and continuation. So these are the kind of similes that really like stick in your mind. You can remember them. And Ajahn Chah used many of these metaphors and similes. So that's one thing that makes him, you know, really quite special. People remember his quite simple teachings. It doesn't have to be anything very kind of high, not abstract, it's practical. The other thing about him was that he was able to teach the foreigners, the Western people who started to come to Ubon to seek him out. One of the first was, of course, then Ajahn Sumedho, who like became a monk and came to live with him. And then more and more of them followed, which then became the start of Wat Pah Nanachat, the international monastery. And until now, which the number of the Western monks has really increased a lot, and there are new branch monasteries everywhere. So, and there's a kind of whole training system developed, mostly using English as a language of communication. So we have developed our own, actually you have to develop a whole language, like a set of terms, terminology within this kind of group to talk about the Dhamma and the Vinaya, again, which takes time, you know, takes generations, few decades to develop that. But now that's been, you know, quite well established, so we can actually communicate in a way that we understand each other, say using English. Not everybody, you know, learns Thai. I only learned Thai later on after I became a monk when I came to Thailand. So some monks never learn Thai, so there is a kind of gap of language gap for some of the Western monks. So it's important to find ways to bridge that kind of gap. So Ajahn Chah, when he came to England on the first visit, and it was, he's never been abroad really, apart from maybe Laos. I think he went to Laos before, Tudong, but traveling to England, you can find now, there are some books published with some records about the trip with photos, and he even wrote a little diary where he records like the things he saw, and it's quite funny to see these old photos of him walking around London and Oxford. But Ajahn Sumedho says that when Ajahn Chah went abroad, he spent like the first few days, he was just kind of looking around, just didn't teach very much, just looked, observed how people live there, how people behave, how people walk, their way of life, looking at the buildings, how they live. He just wanted to understand the different culture, understand the mentality of the people there, which was very different, I think, from like rural northeast Thailand that he was familiar with. And then after a few days, then he started to meet Westerners who were interested in meditation, and people came to offer food, and he found a new way of teaching them. He had to adapt. He was very good at basically not just being kind of stuck in just in his own culture, but he was able to see, okay, these certain things like culture is just a convention. Culture is not a like a paramattha, something ultimate, but it's a samuti. It's just something that is agreed on, that's something that people agree to do things in this particular way. You know, this culture, this group of people thinks that this form of behavior is polite and this form of behavior is suitable this time and place, but in another country another group of people may disagree and do it another way. So he observed that, you know, if we become too attached to just one way of doing things, then it gives rise to kile, some kind of defilements in the mind and suffering. So he would often make some comments like that. Like when he goes to the West, he said like people would come and listen to the talk, and in the West, it's like men and women can like sit very close together, and then after they finish the meditation, they will like touch each other or something, or touch each other on the head, which he said in Thailand would be considered impolite, or he wouldn't do that. But for him, he just commented on it like, well, that's just behavior. It's just the samut, something that's convention. It's not, it doesn't matter, We don't have to make a big deal of forcing people to do things just our way. So he could see what are the essential qualities, the essential Dhamma teachings, and then what's just changeable and things you can adapt. So he was able to make the distinction, not to be attached to the whole kind of convention, because there were other Thai monks who came to England and maybe they couldn't make the same adaptation, so they thought it was unsuitable to leave monks in England, so the monks couldn't really practice the way in Thailand. But Ajahn Chah, he said, no, you can adapt, and that's possible. For example, it's very cold, it's raining all the time, so you have to wear something under your robe, some clothes, warmer clothes, even the way we eat or the way we do the bindabad, arms round. It has to be different. There's different ways. We can't insist, in England or in the West, anywhere, at 6 o'clock in the morning, if you go out bindabad, there's nobody, people are still in bed, or nobody has like cooked rice and isn't waiting to put food in your bowl. But it can be arranged another way. We can arrange, maybe 11 o'clock, monks will go to the town near the shopping center and people will come and put food in their bowl, because that's the time when people go shopping, buying some food for their meal. It's more convenient that way, so okay, why not? So things can be adapted. And also about the whole weather. Like I said, in Norway, it might be just snow and very cold the whole winter. So we usually, in the Western monasteries, we have like a so-called winter retreat, which is similar to the pansa, like a kao pansa in Thailand. In Thailand, it's usually in the rainy season, it's raining, it's not really convenient to go anywhere, so you have to like stay in the monastery, and it's a good time to actually be stable and not travel anywhere and do a lot of meditation and study. So we do that also in the summer, but then the time for meditation is more in the winter, actually. It's more convenient and it's more practical. If you have snow outside, it's actually quite peaceful, not much noise or anything. So it can be a really good time to develop samadhi, develop, you know, the stillness of the mind. So we usually do that for this time of year. Right now, people in England or in the Western monasteries will be on a winter retreat, not having any other activities, just doing a lot of meditation. And so when I go back, there will be more time to spend with that. And then in the summer, the weather is good. It's really nice in the summer. Lots of people want to come and visit. Or you have to go out, have some activity in the summer. So we just adapt to what's necessary. Today I was given also a bit of a guided tour here of the archive, of Buddhadasa archive, which is something that I find interesting, looking at old things and sort of studying a bit of history, being aware of history, just something to learn from. And people who don't know history, there's a saying that you'll be making the same mistakes all over again, so it's good to study a bit of history. And of course Ajahn Buddhadasa was just like Ajahn Chah, the kind of interesting combination, the two of them. You might have heard that they kind of respected each other, and I think Ajahn Buddhadasa even like prepared a kuti to receive Ajahn Chah, but he never came, he couldn't make the visit anymore. But they kind of, their teachings are quite complementary, I would say. Ajahn Buddhadasa was more of a scholar. He studied the Pali texts and all kinds of other books, and even in English, and had a lot of that kind of background knowledge. But his teachings on meditation and everything were very practical. So Ajahn Chah would recommend, like he told Ajahn Sumedho, if you want to read some books, you should read Ajahn Buddhadasa's books. Or even if you want to learn Thai, you can learn Thai from his books. Because he felt the way Ajahn Buddhadasa would interpret the Pali text, the Sutta text, it was very practical. So myself, when I was still a student in Prague, in Czech Republic, I translated some of these books. I found it a good way to do some kind of Dhamma work. You know, if you work working for the Dhamma, it's something we can all do in different ways. And at that time, you know, when I try to do meditation, when we start, there's a lot of maybe still thinking going on. Some kind of, you can't make the mind completely still, but it's possible to channel the thinking in a particular way. You know, if you have a topic or a theme to focus on, you can like channel your thinking, and it'll lead you eventually to like a stillness of mind. And if you do something like Dhamma reading or translation work, anybody who's ever done some kind of translation, it's actually kind of like a contemplation. You take in these kind of words, information, and you have to like turn them over in your mind and reflect on the meaning, and then consider, you know, what's the best way to put this into another language. So if you learn more languages also, that's useful, because it makes you less kind of dependent on one particular set of concepts. Every language, some languages are quite similar, other languages are very different, like translating from Thai into a Western, like European language, or from Pali into a Western language, or from Pali into Thai. It has its challenges. It's not so simple. These kind of computer translations don't always work, especially don't use the Google Translator for Dhamma books. That's a very bad idea. Because you really have to think about it. You have to consider the meaning. And the sort of, even the artificial intelligence, I don't know, maybe they they developed some new method now, but usually they don't get it very, very correct. So it's a way of contemplating the Dhamma. It's using reflection, contemplation, reflect on the meaning of these words, and then that's the way you remember them. And then you can put it into practice later on. You can see when you get stuck somewhere in your meditation practice, maybe you remember that particular teaching that you just translated a while ago. So that's a very good way to do this. And I translated some of the books by Ajahn Chah, Ajahn Buddhadasa, Ajahn Sumedho, and others. And also because I learned some Pali language before myself, I was interested to look at the original teachings of the Buddha. And then you compare that to the sort of the later teachings of the modern teachers. So you have a whole kind of different levels of the Dhamma terminology and concepts and words. So you know how it all kind of fits together. So you don't get kind of confused. Sometimes listening to Dhamma teachings, if you are not familiar with it, it's easy to get a bit confused. You don't know, what's the real essence and what's just the on the outside. It's good to become familiar with the basic teaching, structures, and then fill in like the details. So all these things are aspects of panya. Panya in Buddhism has got many meanings, different levels of panya. There's the panya that has to do with just strictly speaking with meditation, understanding like anicca, dukkha, anatta. That's the kind of wisdom that leads to liberation from suffering. So that's the most important one. But there's different other levels of panya which have to do with like understanding, like language and how to communicate with others. So this is important for people who are, if you are like in the teaching profession, if you're a teacher or working with other groups of people, you're trying to communicate information. That's a kind of skill that everybody needs to have. And it's part of the Buddhist, the Buddhist teachings as well. You find a lot of that. And there's the whole kind of tradition that developed after the Buddha, the commentaries, the attakatha, different ways of like explaining the Buddhist teachings. So there's a lot actually in the Buddhist tradition that we can learn from. And that's what I was referring to before, this analytical knowledge, knowledge of language, niruti patisambhida. And it's not something that everybody has. Not all modern teachers have the same ability to explain the Dhamma, precisely or the same way as the Buddha did, because maybe some people haven't learned much or haven't studied much. They might use their own terms, their own language. So sometimes when you compare, this teacher talks about meditation in this way and that teacher, some other way, why is it they don't agree? Maybe the followers will argue with each other, who is right, who is wrong. And that's just normal, that's going to happen, because not everybody has that same ability to formulate and put things in a very clear way. Of course, the best way is, look at how the Buddha used to teach. What kind of questions did the Buddha answer, and what kind of questions did the Buddha put aside? There are some things that the Buddha actually said, it's not worth answering this kind of question, because the problem is with the person asking the question. The Buddha wouldn't always give you a direct answer to everything. Because if the question is coming from like a misunderstanding in your own mind, then you can't get a good enough answer. Ajahn Chah really demonstrated this very well. When he went to America, there was this time he was giving a talk, and one lady asked him about what happens to the mind of an arahant when the arahant has passed away. When an arahant dies, what happens with the mind of the arahant, the chit of the arahant, what happens with it? and Lumbo Cha, he had this candle next to him. There was a candle burning there. So he said, well, if this candle burns out, it's finished, or I blow out the flame, where does the flame go? Does it go, you know, up or down, or north, east, west? And of course the answer was, we can't say where it goes, it just goes out, but we can't define it, we can't say where it went. And then Ajahn Chah asked this lady, do you like my answer? She said no. And then he said, well, I don't like your question. Yeah, because the problem was with her assumption. So the assumption in her mind was such that, you know, she wanted to define something, you know, where put some kind of a box or definition around this idea of the arahant, and where does the mind of arahant go, where does it belong, put it like in a box of concept. But it doesn't work like that. The Buddha wouldn't never define it like that. So it's not beyond, it's beyond definition. So Ajahn Chah demonstrated very well, you know, how you have to like put the question back to the person who asked it, and they have to change the way of thinking. Yeah? So like I think Einstein had this same saying that he said, you can't solve the problem using the same mindset that sort of formulates the problem. You have to like change the mindset, in order to find a solution to a problem. Mm. So change your way of thinking. Mm. So these are just a few words today on Ajahn Chah's kind of special way of teaching and how they affected also me. I was influenced by them. Obviously a very big influence on me. Of course, we are all dependent on our teachers, so I stayed mostly in the beginning with Ajahn Sumedho, Lumbo Sumedho, and received a lot of these teachings through him. So there's a lot of gratitude for that. And so we can learn from books and we can learn from living teachers, but always to bring it back to the, like, the timeless quality, what's akaliko, you know, what is beyond the time, particular time. So we have to look at the universal kind of teachings. So I'll just stop here, and maybe if anybody has some questions.
Now it's time for questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand up and we will give the microphone to you.
So the question in Thai, how to work with the tanha, craving. So there's all kinds of ways. If you study the teachings of the Buddha about the five hindrances or nivarana, nivonha, so it's one of them is the way the mind behaves when there is some kind of mental object comes up. We have some kind of arom in the mind, then we can either follow it, go after it, or we don't like it, we go back and backwards, kind of like a repulsion. These two basic ways of dealing with approaching a mental object. So this is actually one way. Ajahn Chah used to say that the practice of Dhamma, when people ask him about what's the best way to practice meditation, practice Dhamma, and he said, well, it's not about any particular type of practice, you know, sitting, walking, this technique or that technique. There are many meditation techniques and methods, but what it comes down to is, he said, when the mind meets with the mental object, you know, what happens? So there is the arom kratopchit, pasa. It's called pasa or contact. So that happens all the time at the six ayatana, the sense bases. And the purpose of developing sati sampajanya is to be able to catch that moment. So every time, you know, something happens like a idea, thought comes up in the mind, some kind of image, you know, then if we have sati, if we develop sati, sampajanya, this kind of mindfulness, awareness, then the mind will be more quick to just catch the mind. You can catch the mind before it follows this mental object or does something about it, repels the object. So we become more and more aware, you know, when we start to follow some kind of way of thinking, you know, maybe something we really like, you know, start to think about some really nice food I want to eat tomorrow, you know, when we meditate, start to think about, oh, ice cream. And then some people get really lost, you know. Can Ajahn Chah, you know, he's very good if you read his biography. Later we'll have his biography. He said when he was a young monk, he could spend a whole hour just sitting there thinking about, what was it, bananas or something, sweet bananas, and something he could eat, something really delicious, and he would spend a whole hour. So he wasn't really like different from anybody else. He had a lot of this kind of mental hindrances, nivon. But he learned, he was observing the way his mind behaved, and then he learned from that. He said he learned from these hindrances or nivon. So you learn, you know, slowly, like what's the best way, you know, to catch the mind when it starts to follow a thought. You'll be able to catch it and then pull it back. If you can't pull it back, to stay with something like the breathing, anapanasati. Another way is to direct the mind to another object. So you can bring up some other kind of image, you know, like you can train yourself. It's just using imagination, actually. All the time we have this, what we call sanya, kanta working. It's like when we look at something, we associate that thing with something else. We have memories and other images surrounding it. And it depends on how we like put our, where we put our attention, what we follow. So you look at somebody you find really, really attractive, and then that particular image, okay, you find somebody attractive. But you can, because you focus on like either the whole image or any particular details. But you can also use your imagination to focus on other things. You can imagine the person, another person. It's not just the skin and the hair and the way they are arranged. Behind that, there's you've got the teeth, you've got the bones, you've got other parts of the body, which normally, you know, we don't want to focus on because they are not attractive. So you can experiment like this. You can actually, it's quite fun. You know, you can like really have fun with this, play with images in the mind. You can imagine other people being more like kind of, just imagine somebody just being more like a skeleton, you know, like bones, moving around, sitting, walking, or different parts of the body. You can sort of take it apart and put it back together. So this is a kind of good way of practice in the beginning, just to break down the kind of our usual way of perceiving or looking at somebody else. And then you will be able to use this, you know, you can actually choose, you'll have much more choice where you point your mind. You won't be like a slave to your habits. Normally most people who don't train their mind in meditation, they just follow the old habits all the time. And the older you get, the more you follow just the same old habits, so you get kind of stuck, become a certain personality, have certain habits, and old people often they just keep repeating the same old things. So if you realize this, then it's better to start early, as early as possible in life. Try to train the mind so you have more choice in where you put your attention. You know, you start to think about something that's unwholesome, you know, it's akuson, akusala. Then you move your attention to something else that's wholesome, kuson. So you have to experiment a little bit and see which method works.
Mm-hmm. What do you usually do when some people take advantage of you?
What to do when people take advantage of you? Yes, living in the world, in the normal person, you know, the karawat, you have to deal with all kinds of people doing work, business or whatever. Then some people are honest, some people are dishonest, might take advantage of you, treat you in a bad way. That's just part of the life experience, and most often you can, at least what you can do as a basic practice is not to get too overwhelmed by this kind of feeling, oh, why, how can they treat me like this, you know, I don't deserve to be treated like this. Maybe some people will think, oh, I must have done something really bad in the past, you know, some bad gum in the past, so they treat me like this. It's just a kind of way of explaining it to yourself, really. It's like a trick. It might work, you know, at least you accept it. Okay, well, I probably did something bad to them, so now they treat me in a bad way. But anyway, we can reflect. The Buddha encouraged people to reflect the Pramvihansi, four Brahma Vihara. And the last one is the Upekha, which is actually quite difficult. But the way to develop it, to make the mind kind of balanced, is just reflecting on the kamma, koteng kam. So it's just reflecting that whatever we do or whatever other people do, eventually we will, if they do something bad to us, eventually it'll come back to them, you know. So in a way, if they do some unskillful, not good thing to us, you know, really we should feel sorry for them, because eventually they will get the bad results themselves, sooner or later, you know. They probably in themselves, they can't feel very good, people like that. They can't have any kind of self-respect or feel very good about themselves. So we shouldn't be like pulled into their negativity, you know, they did something bad to us. So we try to maintain our own, you know, our inside our own mind, kind of a healthy and good state of mind as much as possible. So even if something might happen to us, like we might lose some money or we might lose some material things, the most important thing is not to lose your inner kind of goodness, you know, inner peace of mind. You might lose, you know, somebody might steal your car or a house burns down, whatever, but it doesn't matter so much. If, you know, the main thing is your own state of mind. So just try and reflect like this. If you can do something about it, that's possible, but never sure if it's gonna work. At least, you know, look after your own mind.
Do you have any suggestions or techniques to create a habit of meditating constantly, or to stay mindful, like, maybe throughout the days, like, when we have sensations or before?
Yes, common question. People living in a busy life in the city, how to keep the continuity, maintain the practice going. Well, there are different ways. You can make a determination to get up very early every morning, because early morning is a good time to meditate before you start thinking about this and that. It's like almost becomes a, it can become a habit, you know, that you basically get up, wash your face, maybe drink a cup of tea, just to wake up earlier than you would normally, and then you can sit, meditate for half an hour or whatever. It's a good way to prepare for the day. You know, I used to find, before I was a monk, that if I did that, then it would be like charging one's battery, you know, for the whole day. Then you feel much more like you've got some energy and you don't get so exhausted during the day. Whatever you have to do, any kind of task, if you use your thinking mind a lot or anything you need to do, you've got like energy. But if you haven't meditated in the morning, it's often like you use up the energy. It's hard to get it back. You can feel kind of exhausted. Then also you can meditate before going to bed in the evening to kind of clear the mind of any residues of the day. things that have happened, but often it might not be that peaceful as the morning meditation. But it's again a good way to kind of clear the mind, and so you can go to sleep easily. So I recommend that to people also. But if you wanna, there are all kinds of like methods you could create. I know some people, they have like a group, like on the internet, have some kind of group where all the members, they have to sort of make a determination, and you know, this time every day we will go and meditate, and then they can see, oh, is everybody meditating? So you get like group pressure. It's a good method. So you don't want to be, you know, seen not to do it. There's all kinds of tricks like that you can play on yourself. But through the day, I mean, even living in a big city like this, just walking on the street, I think in Bangkok it's a bit dangerous to walk on the street. So you have to have a lot of sati, not to like fall in some hole or some car drive over you. But anyway, the body movement, just focus, staying focused on the movement of the body is a good thing anytime. So meditation doesn't have to be like this particular form, sitting all the time. But if you stay, try to maintain that awareness of the body, the movement of the body, any kind of little tasks that you might be doing during the day, try to stay with the mindfulness of the movements of the body is very good. And then when you come and sit down in the evening, say, then you find you can focus on something like the breath more easily, because your mind has been already trained through the day. So I think there'll be a chance to receive some books today. Huh? We have Ajahn Gavesako. He has written the biography of Ajahn Chah in English. And there was a Thai biography, the Upalamani, which was published many years ago around the time of Ajahn Chah's funeral. But then we were waiting for the English version for many years, and now it came to this anniversary, so finally he managed to complete his homework, and he has written this more than 300 pages, and it's called Stillness Flowing, which actually refers to one of the similes, this upama that Ajahn Chah used about the mind. To explain what it means is Ajahn Chah said, like, the way we practice meditation is to make the mind still, but not still, completely still, that nothing like is moving in the mind. He said your mind needs to be still to some degree, but there's still things happening in the mind, but you have the wisdom, then you develop the wisdom from watching the movement, you know, like different mental objects move through the mind, come through the mind, and then you can see them clearly and let go of them. So that's what is flowing stillness flowing, what that means.
That's like, I would like to share with us something about the project now at Chithurst Monastery.
So what I explained before was just the project we have about building the kuti, so for the monks and the monks to live in the forest in Norway. So we are just starting talking with the architect. We have plans to build a kuti. There's some information printed over there if you want to see. So anybody can, if you feel like helping with that, that's very welcome. And then we have some accommodation for the lay people already, and Ubasok, Ubasika, anybody who is visiting Norway, you're welcome to come and visit. Possible to stay. I have some information here, actually, some leaflets about Norway. If anybody would like to get it, I can give you one brochure. Also, we want to do the one idea is the Buddharupa. It's like, you know, see this style, and we would like to make one from sandstone that looks like the original Greek style of Gandhara. You ever read about the earliest Buddha statues made in India, Pakistan, Afghanistan? They looked like a Greek face. They were made by the Greek artist. So something like that. That's the project. Like I said, with the developing the sati, like a continuous flow of water, you know. So first we do it, and the reason is difficult because we don't develop the sati sampajanya, the kind of continuous awareness during the day. So you start with that, you can do it all the time, you know, during your daily life. Just be maybe slow down a little bit, doing things a bit more slowly with awareness what you're doing. You know, this idea, being aware, and then try to sit down. Maybe sometimes the mind is just too kind of unsettled and busy, so you can't really sit for very, very long, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. But it's better than not doing it at all. So even if you sit for 10 minutes every day, it's still good, you know, if you do it and determine to do it every day. It becomes like a habit, like a good habit. And then, but you find sometimes also it's important to choose the right time of day. You know, if you choose the wrong time of day to meditate, say straight after the meal, when you had a big meal, you'll be sleepy, you know, feeling tired, or when you're very busy, then every time you meditate, your mind will be just busy, fung san, and then you always feel frustrated, so you don't have any motivation to continue the meditation. So if you know there is some particular time of day which is best for you, then try to meditate at that time, and then you get some kind of good feeling from it, some reward, you know, then will motivate you to meditate a bit longer until you get to the point when meditation just becomes pleasant. You know, in the beginning it's unpleasant because you force yourself to do something you haven't done before, creating a new habit. But when you get a little bit more skilled, then every time you sit down, you get a sense of refreshment from, if you do like anapanasati, just focusing on the breathing, even for a few seconds, if you really do it, you become familiar with it, you get a sense of relaxation, refreshment coming from it. You don't have to force yourself. And then you won't have to, after that, it'll be automatic. You will like to sit down and meditate. It's almost like part of your life. Doesn't have to be. I mean, it's, you have to see for yourself. Everybody is really different in this, you know, either morning or evening or before the meal, after the meal, depends. Try different times, you know. Also, you can try walking meditation, you know, jomkrom. Some people find that better. Start with that. And then you can do some walking meditation, 20 minutes, you know, focusing every step. And then your mind already, like, becomes more focused. Calm down, and then you sit after. That's quite a good way to do it.